My hope in putting this presentation together was just to give you a glimpse of what student affairs is and what we do here on campus, and talk a little bit about where we're going and some of the things we hope to be doing with student affairs into the future. So for those, there's many of you I haven't had a chance to meet. I actually started here in July. So if your student didn't start this year, we probably have not had a chance to meet each other. And so officially, my name is Kerry Greenstein. I'm our new Dean of Student Affairs. So I've been here since July and absolutely loving it. I love Beacon. I love the students. They're wonderful. And so it really makes my job easy and fun, which is one of the benefits of being in student affairs, that you get to spend all your time with the students, especially when your office is right there in the middle of the student center and life is here. And so you're constantly seeing and hearing students out here and knowing what's going on, and kind of hearing all the excitement that they have for what they're doing. And so that's what makes my job so enjoyable. So I hope to give you a little bit of some of where I'm coming from, some of what I've seen, and then moving forward, what I hope to bring to Beacon. And so that's really the objectives for this presentation for you. So who we are. Student affairs encompasses a lot on campus, and so there's a lot of different parts to what I oversee and what I work with, and the things that we try to do for the benefit of the students. And so you see here just a general list, athletics and fitness, campus activities, campus safety, our health clinic where the nurse is, housing and residence life, our student center, this building and the bookstore, and transportation. Then there are some other areas that I'm responsible for, some of the not so fun areas like judicial affairs and dealing with the violations of our code of conduct, and then complaints and other things that students have to deal with. But we do certainly take those very seriously and try to address those. And so where we've been, to give you some general idea, I talked about being new myself. Really, we started with, dealing with some vacancies, to put it plainly. There was nobody in my position for quite some time before I got here. And so not to say anything negative about the people that were here or that are here with me, they did a great job with what they had, quite frankly. And so they were all filling multiple roles, doing lots of things, and really just keeping their heads above water, trying to provide for students the best that they could. And they did a great job of that. But I think now that I'm here, and then one of the other things we did was, of course, fill some of our other openings. We had an opening in the clinic and got a new nurse, who is absolutely wonderful for the students. The students love her, and she cares so much about the students, and she absolutely loves being here. And then campus safety, to make sure that we're providing a safe campus for students and that we have opportunities for, or that we had a full staff that would be rotating to be here to protect our students and protect the campus grounds. And so really filling the vacancies was a number one priority to get us up to speed, get everybody here. Staff training, in the past, I think, like I said, they really were just kind of keeping their heads above water and being down people, you don't have the time to get away, you don't have the time to develop yourselves. And so training was certainly an issue that I saw as I was coming in, and something that we're working towards. Constantly changing bus routes. One of the things I learned quickly after getting here is that every semester, if not multiple times throughout the semester, we were changing bus routes and making changes and tweaking it this way and tweaking it that way and trying to constantly change the bus to figure out how do we best maximize this and make the best use of the transit system that we have. That being said, there was also a huge increase in demand. As you just heard from the president, our numbers were going up, so clearly there's more students to transport, but also students were using it more and asking for more transportation to be provided for different things, everything from getting to and from campus to their apartments, to medical appointments, to the activities and everything. So there's a huge increase in demand for the use of our buses and our transportation system. And then at the end of the day, a lot of this comes down to housing. And that's a big part of what we do in student affairs. The roommate conflicts, the roommate problems, dealing with those was a major, major part of what the staff was working on and what we continue to deal with. It, as the president said, we know that our students want to have singles. Many, if not all, of our students would love to have a private space to go back to kind of decompress and be on their own at the end of the day. And we haven't been able to offer that. And so when you then have roommates, you're bound to have some conflicts. And that happens everywhere. But certainly with our population, we have a little bit higher level of that. And so we need to help them through that and help them deal with those skills of living with someone else. Many of our students, like most places, come having had a private room all their lives and never having to share, and having to share for the first time, even in the apartment, having to share, even if they do get the private space, there are issues and concerns that we have to deal with and work through. And so we certainly spend a lot of time on dealing with those roommate agreements, and where we can, making the changes when we have space available, and how do we kind of, it's like a jigsaw puzzle, honestly, trying to figure out, you know, okay, this one can move here and this one can move here, but how are they going to work together? And the staff knows the students so well that they know, well, this one won't really go well with this one, so maybe we need to think about another switch. As much as we want them out of that situation, it's not going to be any better over here. And so really trying our best to work with what we've got going on, and who we have, and how we can place them appropriately in a situation that's going to be best for them. And so we continually strive to do that, but it certainly creates a challenge for us as we work through those. Other things, programming and activities. We've sort of had a very consistent schedule with what we do with our programming and activities. We do our weekday events here in the Student Center at night. We do some smaller activities. We do some tournaments with the games and the gaming systems, and we play board games and bingo. So we do a lot of smaller activities during the week, and then on weekends we go off campus and we take students to the theme parks and we go to other local attractions and the beaches and the Florida malls and all that other stuff. So we take advantage of what's around, but those are generally on weekends. And so we had a very limited scope of what we were offering and what we were doing and where we're going with that. Our clubs and organizations, that is an interesting area where, you know, we really try and have our student organizations. And honestly, our students continue to come up with great ideas and want to have some student organizations. And then what we find is they get engaged in the first week or two. We just had club fair, great turnout. And then after the next couple of weeks, people stop showing up to those clubs. And I think a lot of that has to do with the leadership and organizational training that our students have. And so when they start leading those organizations and they become the president, sometimes by default they became the president of a club, but they weren't properly trained to be the leader of that club. And so the others show up and then they say, oh, this is disorganized, this isn't run very well, I don't want to be here, and they walk away. And I understand that. And so I think that's where we've been, and you're going to hear in a little bit some of the things we're going to do to hopefully try and change some of that. And then judicial affairs. We spend a lot of time with that, just kind of enforcing policies, everything from our guest policies to dealing with alcohol and drugs and other issues. Again, pretty typical for a college campus to be dealing with. And then no contact agreements has been something that I'm used to doing. But in my first semester here, I probably did more of them than I had done in 8 years at my previous institution. And I think that what I found over time is that it's because our students get very emotional. And so they have a little disagreement and it's very emotional and we need to stop talking and I want a no contact agreement. And okay, all right. And so we put those in place and we would do those. And you're gonna hear from me in a little bit some of the things I'm looking to do a little bit differently to help them learn and grow from some of that a little bit. So it's not just so cut and dry. Okay, just don't talk to each other. We have 300 students on this campus. You are bound to see each other. You're bound to be in classes together. We have one dining facility where everyone's gonna eat in the same hour and a half time frame, you're gonna see each other. So let's figure out how we can talk and not have to feel this awkward no contact rule being put in place. So that's some of the things that I've seen and some of the areas where I hope to make some changes here. So my important lessons learned, what have I learned in my first semester here? I think our students do have a desire for involvement. I think they want to be involved, they want to be engaged. And that excites me. I think that's what we want. That's what we hope to hear. There's a lot of talk that some of our students just go back to their rooms and hide out. That is true for some. That is. But the majority of our students, I really believe, want to be involved, want to be active. And I've seen that in a number of ways. Our club fair attendance. In the fall, we had over 200 students at the club fair. And even in the spring, as returning this semester, we had 170 students show up to that. So students want to sign up, want to be a part of these clubs and organizations. That to me is wonderful. If every student got involved, we're on the right track. So I think we're making some progress there, and that's something that was really encouraging to me. Fitness and athletics. There seems to be this theory that our students don't work out and don't go to the gym and they eat at the chopping block and they take the bus, and so everyone comes here and just gains weight. And that may be true for some, but we're hoping to not have that. And so I talked to fitness and athletics and we started to track. They get sign-in sheets for everything that they do. Every time a student walks into the gym, even for just working out on their own, they track that. And what we found is that 45% of students, or almost 44.8% of students, had shown up to the gym or shown up to one of their activities or one of their programs or fitness events. That tells me something. Students are working out. They are doing activity, physical activity, in a positive way. So students are engaged, and that's step number one to what we're really trying to create here. Some of what we're doing is limited by transportation, and I recognize that. So we take these great trips on the weekends. Well, our largest bus on campus is 28 students. That's all it can fit. Well, we've got 300, so that's leaving me 275 odd students that there is no activity for. And I recognize that, and I recognize that as a challenge, and we're hoping to fix that and make that better. Now, sometimes athletics will do something else so we can get another 20 students there, but by and large, there just isn't enough transportation to take them all, because they'd all love to go to Disney when we take them, and there just isn't the space to do it. I did find in my first semester that the minority of students took the majority of my time, and that's probably not much of a surprise to anyone. And in my role, and certainly in housing's role, we spend a lot of time with a handful of students that continually cause problems. Or we're just getting into little things. But it took up a lot of our time. And so I'm used to that. I see that a lot. But that's not the way it should be. We need to spend more time with everyone else, all the students who are doing the right things, who are going to class, who are studying, who are doing what they're supposed to be doing. Those are the ones I really want to spend the time with. Those are the ones who want to be engaged. Those are the ones we need to capture and help and support. And so hopefully we're going to find ways that we can continually focus more on the majority and not on that handful that just caused the problems. We'll still deal with those, but hopefully not the majority of our time. The other thing I learned is that the communication with parents, how crucial that is. And not just the communication with parents, but the support from parents. That when we talk to parents and have your support with what we're doing here, how that can make all the difference for us and what we're trying to do. And so I will be the first to admit there were a couple situations I know I probably could have called a parent sooner than I did. I recognize that now. I'm certainly coming from a place where I'm used to not doing that. And we really left parents out of the process. And that's not how things often happen here. And so I think knowing that we have the parent support, and if we communicate with the parents, we're going to be in a lot better shape moving forward. And so how we communicate and where it's appropriate is something we're going to be working towards figuring out and kind of striking that good balance there in how and when we communicate with parents. So those are some of my major lessons. Now let's talk about the fun stuff and where we're going and what I want to do. So for the students in here, some of you have probably not heard all of this yet, which is a good thing, so you'll be the first to hear it. Staff training and professional development. That was extremely important to me when I got here. I mentioned before the staff was just doing their best to keep their heads above water and doing what they could do, but they also really were not very well trained. And so it is a goal of mine to train the staff. And in the next couple of weeks, our housing director is going to be going to her first housing conference. She's been to other conferences, but nothing related to housing. And so I'm excited for her, and she's super excited to go and hear the ideas. She's going to come back from that conference to help our students and change the way we do residence life and housing here, I know she's going to come away with a lot because I've been to those conferences, and I know what she's going to take away from it. And so I'm really excited for her, and our activities director is going to do something like that. Next year, I'm really going to push our campus safety director to get involved in some of those things. And so we're going to really encourage staff to take advantage of professional development opportunities in the area where they can, and not just go away to fancy conferences and spend a lot of money, but to really come back with great ideas. And then how do we implement them here? And one of the benefits to Beacon is that we can, because it hasn't been done before, and we've got the support to do it. And so it'll be real easy to implement some of those things in whatever way we see fit and what we see best. So I think there's a lot of great opportunity from that. So I'm encouraged by them taking part of those. And then we're also doing some internal workshops that we can provide opportunities for them here on campus, and whether it's learning from each other. When they each come back from a conference, I'm going to pull the entire student affairs area together to say, okay, Carrie, when you come back from that housing conference, you tell the rest of us, what did you learn from that? So those who couldn't go, because we're not paying for everyone to go, those who didn't go still hear from her what she got out of it. And then we all brainstorm together how we can make that better. So there's going to be a lot of opportunities for staff to learn and develop and grow themselves so that they can be better to provide better for the students. Independent transportation. I couldn't think of a better way to address that increase in demand than to allow students and student groups to provide their own transportation. I think that's the only way we can do it, and the method we're going to use to try and help us here. And so by doing this, I'm talking about vans. Right now we have these buses that you need to be a certified bus driver in order to drive them. We're going to get some passenger vans that anyone can drive. And so our club advisors will be able to take the vans and take their student group with them when they go somewhere, so that we don't have to rely on a bus and take the bus away from some other activity that someone else wants to do. That's going to give us a lot of opportunity to get these groups engaged and give them opportunities to do the things that they want to do. There's a lot of groups that we've talked to that want to do things like community service and want to get out into the community, and they just don't have the means to get there. And so we're going to find a way for them to get there. The other thing that I've used at a previous institution that I'm excited to try and bring, and we're starting to look into this opportunity, is car sharing. That there's a car that would be here, sort of almost kind of works like an enterprise, like we become the enterprise, and allows us to rent out by the hour to students. So if a couple of students, someone has a license but maybe not their car, I know there's quite a few students who have that situation, they can rent that car for a couple hours and take it to the beach and go with their friends and then come back. And it's a pay service that they get into. It's another opportunity for those who don't have their cars to not rely on the transportation to do those. When I talked about the medical appointments, students may be able to take themselves to the medical appointment by borrowing that car temporarily. So there's some ideas that we have to help ease that burden that will allow the staff to then focus on some of those other things that we're trying to do. Additional housing, you just heard about that. That we're certainly excited about the opportunities to bring additional housing and what that's going to mean for us, providing those additional single spaces, providing space for us in the other facilities so that there could be more singles there. But then again, at the end of the day, being able to make those changes when we need to make a change and know that there's space available. Because right now, we just don't have it. And students are where they are because that's the only space that's available in some cases. Specific housing communities. This is something that I'm really starting to think through of what we can do and how we can do it as we build this new building, thinking who's going to be in that building, who's going to stay in the villages, who's going to be over in Commons and at Woodward, and creating specific communities within there. From day one, I always heard Woodward is sort of the quiet space. Everybody likes the quiet over at Woodward. Nothing ever happens over at Woodward. And that's good. Now we need to harness that, that's the identity of that community. What's the identity of the Commons? What's the identity of the villages? And how do we create those communities? And what I'd love to get to is a point where we take our older students, our juniors and seniors, and help them over in the Commons. That they're going to be over in the Commons, but we start to ease some of the rules and the restrictions that we have over at the villages, where we've got our new students, or their new students are going to be in the new building, that we can put some ease on the rules and the restrictions, and more free living, maybe fewer RAs, fewer rounds, but it gives us the opportunity to let them be more independent and grow into that experience as they get to their upper years. But in their lower years, still be closer to campus, be more supervised and have some of the restrictions and earn those rights as they move up. And so it gives students opportunities to build. Also would love to do it based on major, be able to have a building that is specific to a major. So we've got a lot of psychology majors, and maybe have a psychology housing, or maybe have some housing specifically for students who have an interest in music. And how do we pull students with an interest in the arts together? Even if we don't have an arts program, but we can pull them together, and then maybe they create something for us based on that. So it does give us an opportunity to create special interests and common links between students, so that now you also know right off day one, you've got a common interest with that, with your roommate and with your neighbors, and you can build from there. And so that's some of the things that I think we can do really effectively there. And then I talked about our no contact agreements. We're looking to really build some mediation into this and really talking to students about the skills that it's going to take to work through conflicts and resolve those conflicts together. And if it takes a staff person to sit with them and have that conversation, so these two people that don't want to talk anymore, let's sit down together and talk out what these issues are and how do we resolve this in a mature, responsible way. How do you deal with this? Because guess what? Soon you're going to be out in the work world and you can't just say, I'm just not going to talk to a coworker that you don't like. You got to work with them and you got to work through that. And so help them understand that and help them build from there so that they can learn those skills. And eventually, when they do get out into that work world, they won't need us there to help them, that they can do that on their own and be much more productive. Some of these other things are more of my strategic initiative, things I want to work towards that I'm mentioning. One of my big focuses is on our clubs and organizations. I think there's great opportunity to build them and to grow through our student organizations, build our students and their leadership skills. Like I said, right now, they may not be there. They may not have those, but they have the potential. And so we can work with our students to build that into them by providing leadership workshops and trainings, maybe a class that students can opt into for leadership, but giving them those opportunities. I think the students are interested and would be interested if we do it in a good way. And so we're working towards providing that so that then when they, after that club fair and they have all these great names, 200 some students signed up for their organization, they actually keep them in their organization because they know how to lead that group. And that they've got a purpose and a mission and they know what they're doing. And then they've got the transportation to get them to things. So it's all coming together when we work towards some of those things. We definitely want to build the athletics program and try to increase what we do with our athletics. And I've been thinking a lot about this and I think where we're headed is towards identifying what is Beacon Athletics. You know, let's be honest, we are never going to have a D1 football team. Right? That is not our goal. That's not what we're shooting for. So what is Beacon? What can Beacon provide? What can Beacon offer? And so we're trying to figure out what that might be. And right now we're thinking some of these more individualized sports, things like tennis and golf. We're in Florida. There's a golf course on every corner. There's a tennis court no matter where you go. Can we capitalize on those things? So we need to be thinking of in those terms of what are our athletics that we can build, that we can develop, and then from there build some strong athletics program and what we can get out of that. And then also continuing some of the others for just intramurals and activities and allowing students to still come and engage in some of those others. We do a flag football that students enjoy, but how do we teach them some of those skills? Because a lot of our students are coming without even knowing how to play these sports. They haven't played them. And so teaching them as well and being able to find opportunities to do that. Service. I mentioned that briefly a minute ago. I'm really interested in getting our students involved in more service opportunities. I think our students are interested in it and have taken on some great challenges already this past semester when we did some fundraisers and we're donating toys and donating turkeys around the holidays. Our students came together, our student groups, some of them with the help of their advisors, really came through. And so I think the interest is there. And one of the things I'd love to be able to build and develop here are some specific service opportunities. Two in particular. One is an alternative break. So rather than during spring break, they all come home to you, although you may want them to come home to you, that we would provide for a small group of students an opportunity to go somewhere and do what's called an alternative break. And during that break, they go and they provide a week long of service in some area. Or maybe the first week after May. Or while some are traveling with Dr. Chandler on the abroad trip, maybe a different group is going with us somewhere else in June for a week to do service. So I want to be able to provide that in-depth, week-long service to one agency, to one supporting organization that we can really build a tie with and then continue to build from there. I also want to be able to generate some regular trips that we would do. This past semester, we started one where we started going every couple of weeks to a horse ranch. And we, again, we're limited by transportation. We can only take four students each time. And so we want to be able to continue to build these opportunities where we have these connections in the community where maybe we're headed to the food bank or we're headed to an after-school program or something else where we can take a handful of students or a busload of students to that program, and every week we know students can go. And it's, you know, there's no commitment on the student's part, but if they know that we're going, maybe they show up this week, but next week they've got a big assignment they're working on and they can't go. That's okay, as opposed to having to schedule it in ways that the students can't participate. So we want to be able to provide those opportunities to them. I think it's important that we increase Beacon pride. And I've said this really since my first day on campus, that I think we need to do a really good job of finding opportunities to get students to really feel proud of being here and being at Beacon. I don't want it to be the, you know, I came to Beacon because it's the only school that really was good for me and where I could be successful. I want people to say, yeah, that might be true, but I love Beacon. and here's what I'm getting out of it, and here's why Beacon's so great for me. That's what I want them to take away from this, and to really be proud and enjoy their experience while they're here. And so there's a lot of ways we can do that. And so we're looking at those. We're looking at what are the traditions that we have, and right now there aren't many, but what are the traditions, and can we build some? How do we create traditions that students are going to get engaged in and look forward to year after year after year to say, this is something I'm proud of and something I participated in. And ultimately, years from now, they can come back and say, Beacon's still doing that, and that's something that I loved doing when I was a student there. So I'm looking to find those opportunities. And then I talked about the housing communities and how we can build some pride through there, that, you know, I lived at the Villages, and you know, really kind of feeling pride in where they are, where they live, their community, and who they know and who they're with, building the pride around those things as well. A couple other things I'll mention. Regular feedback from students. I could not do my job if I didn't hear from students. It's called the Dean of Students. It's my job to represent the student voice on campus. And so I can't do that effectively if I don't hear from students. And so I am very intentionally creating opportunities for me to hear from students and get student feedback. The first and foremost is our Student Government Association. This past semester, the SGA went through a process where we actually expanded the SGA and created more representative opportunities, because there were seven students engaged in student government, and that's all that the Constitution allowed for. So we've expanded that to create representatives from these housing communities that now represent the housing community that can come and talk to us from SGA. But what that does is give me more student feedback. I'm also hoping to build some leadership opportunities through that and some other things for the students in SGA, but it gives me some valuable information about what's going on with students and what they're looking for and what they're interested in. More importantly is our Dinner with the Dean series of programs. We started that one time in the fall, and we're going to be doing that again. Actually, this coming Wednesday is our next one, so students, please show up. We're going to have a good dinner for you. And then every month thereafter, we're going to do this. And so really, we just set up in here. We provide dinner, because that's what gets students to come. Free food and t-shirts, that's what gets students to show up. But they're going to be here, we'll have dinner, and it's really just an open forum opportunity to talk to me. I'll give them answers, tell them some of the things they don't always get to hear Dr. Haggerty say that I do. I'm going to give them that feedback, and I'll be real honest with them. But also answer their questions, answer their concerns. But then it's also really good for me to hear what their concerns are. And I ask them some questions and get some feedback from them at those opportunities that I can then take when I sit with Dr. Haggerty, when I sit with Dr. Chandler, and say, this is what students are telling me. This is what students say. This is what students want. This is what students need. And here's what we need to provide as an institution for them. And so that's a really valuable opportunity for me. The one time last semester, it was an hour and a half straight, just student questions and comments and suggestions. It was wonderful. And so really valuable information, and so I'm excited to continue that. And then the last big piece to what I'm hoping to do, at least right now, is to really expand our orientation program. I think we can do a better job of transitioning our students here so that when they get here, they're more prepared and more ready for that first day of classes. And so what does that look like? I'm not exactly sure. But how do we expand the orientation program in a way that will allow students to kind of get all the information they need without overwhelming them, because that's often the problem with orientation programs, that you give too much information and they can't take it all in. But how do we get them what they need in a way that's going to be effective and allow them to apply it that's going to help them? And so that's really a key part to what we're doing. And one of the things we're going to do through that is really expand that into what is generally known as a first-year experience program, and continue that orientation. So it's sort of an extended orientation into the first semester and that first year primarily, to really add those additional topics. And we'll do some of the basic things, the time management and the study skills and the money management. Those are important issues that we need to cover, that we need to address, but then we're also going to add in some other things. And this last piece is a strengths initiative, is something that I am extremely passionate about, something I've done for years now. It's called Strengths Quest. It's an assessment through the Gallup organization. Essentially, it gives students their top talent themes, themes of talent, that areas where they excel naturally. And then there's a whole developmental program through that that we can create throughout the campus to really talk about how do you build those talents into true strengths and how do you apply those in ways that are beneficial to you. And it's really a cool program. It's a cool assessment in a way. And I've taken all the different personality assessments and everything. This one has just stuck with me. And so I'm really excited to bring it to students. I've done it with a small group of people already on campus. I'm starting to introduce it. I've introduced it to some staff so that I can have some help. And so next I'm planning to take it to students and introduce it sort of campus-wide, that all students, when they leave here, will know this is what I'm good at, and this is what I can do and what I can contribute to whatever company, organization, business they might start working for, that they can talk really confidently about what they do and what they do well, and what they do that others maybe can't, and the value that they bring, and again, how we can support them through that. And so there's a lot of things that I'm really excited about, tying that into that first year experience. And so within that first year, every student can really start to know that language and talk confidently about what they do and what they're good at. I think will be so empowering for them. And so I'm excited to see what that will do for the students into their sophomore, junior, and senior years, especially as we're trying to do all of those other pieces when they bring that into their student organizations, when they take that to the service opportunities, when they do all these other pieces. I think it's really going to take their experience to that next level. And ultimately, what I guess I'm getting at is that student affairs in the past has been very much, we're going to just do the best we can, and we're going to put together some programs and some activities, and we're going to offer some athletic programs, and we're going to do some basic things, and we're going to make sure that you're housed and fed and everything's okay. But we're going to step that up. We're going to amp that up, and we're going to give students opportunities to learn outside of the classroom and apply what they're doing outside of the classroom to what they're doing inside the classroom. Because at the end of the day, they're all going to leave with the degree. I very truly believe it's the outside things that are going to make the difference. And that's what makes the difference when they go out into that work world, when they're applying for jobs, what's on their resume. It's those things that are going to make them stand out. And so I'm hoping to create those opportunities and build that in the students so that they can take that with them and really go to that next level themselves. So with that, I will open it up to questions and comments, and we can just have a discussion for however much time we have.
On individual transportation, and I'm going to use Will and the Equestrian Club
yes.
as an example. Can he take other students in his car, go to the equestrian, and come back, and the school covers anything that might happen?
Insurance.
Not really. That is your own insurance and whatever's within your policy.
Okay.
Yeah.
I just want to make sure that
yes,
that
that's good. A good question. We actually had that conversation this week, so yeah. Yes, sir.
What responsibilities do your RAs really have? I mean, they're in the building, but do they monitor police? Oh, yes, she lives in that room. Yes, he lives in that room. But are they active, or are they just tenants, I may ask?
It's a bit of both. So the question was, what are the RAs doing? What are their real roles and responsibilities? Yes, so the RAs are on duty. We have one on duty at each complex every night. And they do rounds, so they'll walk around and see what's going on. Oftentimes they end up sitting outside in their complex and hanging out with other students, and they know who the residents are as well. And so are they necessarily there kind of monitoring and knocking on every door to see who's in the room and is it the right people? No. But they're also available for calls and complaints and emergency situations and clogged toilets and you name it, what else. They're available to help with that, and ultimately then can call to facilities if we need, or call to myself or others that are on call as well.
But there's not active involvement with the students per se.
We're getting there. So last semester was the first time we had our RAs start to program. They had never done that before. Each RA was required to do one program each semester. So we'll continue that. A lot of that programming ended up still happening here because this is the ideal space for that. My hope is to start moving that to the complexes and let them actually program at the villages or at Woodward and find a way to do it there, even if it's on a smaller scale, that they're engaging their residents and communicating more with them. So we're getting there, but right now, no.
One other question, I don't get paid off the question,
yeah,
but this being a special school institution, how can you flip the interest of the students to your clubs, where you go get the students and you bring them to the clubs? Because 90% of this population are not in, oh yeah, I love horses, but I, you know, I just stay in my room because I don't know anybody going.
Yeah.
You know, and that's a real failure that I feel, that something could be done on that part of it.
Yeah. So that's a good point, that some of the students might not still show up to the clubs. So I am approaching it from this idea that part of the problem is the leadership. And I think...
Can you have something other than student leadership?
Yes.
Yes. So we do have the advisors. There are advisors. One of the other things I didn't mention that we are doing, I've started what's called President's Council. And so once a month, we also get together with all the club presidents. And so Gavin, our activities coordinator, and myself will give them some ongoing leadership training within there to help them prepare and plan for their organizations. But a lot of it does come back to the advisor for what you're asking and how involved is the advisor. Some of our clubs, the advisors are great and are extremely involved and take on a lot. Some of them, not so much. And so we're going to continue to work with advisors too. There's a lot of work to be done. So small steps, we'll get there. But I totally agree. I saw a hand up here and then I'll come.
I noticed your talk, unless I missed it. I didn't really hear any talk about the communication between student communication, so they know like all these activities, what's going on.
Yes.
And in terms of other safety issues, weather events and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that Dean Valentine, your predecessor, was working on developing that program and fixing that. And then since he's left, I haven't heard anything about that.
Sure. So what he did, since you mentioned the previous dean, he bought into a program called OrgSync. Got us into a 3-year contract. So we're still working with them. We actually had a trainer here at the end of the spring that came taught us how to use it, because I think when we implemented it last year, we didn't implement it very effectively, and that was part of the problem. So now we've been trained, and we can implement it a lot more effectively, and we've got some plans for that. We're rolling that out now. We've met with some of the clubs and organizations, President's Council, we talked about that, and we're trying to get the president set up first, so that then when we roll it out to students, there's some content in there that we are sharing with them, what activities and programs are going on. So that will be one piece to it. The second step to this is that, there's two parts, and it all relates back to email. What I've learned is that students don't necessarily check their email. That's a problem. We're gonna try to change that. We're gonna work towards getting students to actually check not just their email, but their Beacon email. So we're gonna work on that and encourage them to check their Beacon email regularly, because that's where we're gonna communicate with them. So that's the first part. The second part, I believe that we share way too much with students through their email, and that we share everything with them through email. I made the mistake of getting myself on that student email list, and sometimes I regret that, because we send some pointless stuff to them. It's almost like spam. And so I am harnessing that and pulling that in so that they're really only getting what's key and what's important and what they need to know about the activities, about the programs, about deadlines for things. And so I think those two pieces are gonna help. And I'm hoping that as we cut back on the junk that they get, more students will continue to go to their email. Some of this is gonna be a process. It's not gonna happen instantly. And so when I stand at orientation next year and stress it even more, and a lot of this year's first year students, so those of you who have been with me from the start and don't know anything else, they're showing up. They're at everything. All the things I'm seeing and doing, and a lot of the people, it's first year students at a lot of these things. Not that I don't care about the returning students, but the first year students heard it from me and they got engaged, which I love. We're gonna get the other students too. But I think as we continue that, it's gonna be a process. It's not gonna happen overnight. And I recognize that. And so we're gonna continue to build it and continue to do our best to communicate with them. Students know what's going on up there on our bulletin board. Students are through here. We need to do a better job of posting other ways to campus. The TV, as you walk into this building with now running flyers of what's going on, that's new within the past couple of weeks that we're doing that. So little touches here and there to make sure that they have ways to know what's going on. We continue to make improvements.
Yeah, my question is actually the same one about communication, but there's an element you brought up at the beginning that you all were talking about that I didn't know what that was. And maybe you could tell me what
the OrgSync?
Yes,
So it's a program pretty much for college use. That students will get in. It's very much like Facebook, but it's tied to student organizations and student activities. But we can also create, they're called portals, for different departments on campus. So our life coaching, our counseling, our learning specialists can all create portals that they can then send and feed information out to students. So it's almost like a Beacon feed, Facebook feed, but through this program. The problem and what we ran into last year, students didn't go onto that. And so students said, that's just one more thing for me to look at, and they weren't doing it. So we've got a process in place now that we're gonna use to try and get students engaged. And through the clubs, through the organizations, we're challenging the clubs. We're offering a pizza party to the club that gets the most members signed up. We're giving t-shirts to the club that provides or that has the most content up. And that's all gonna be rolled out throughout this semester. So first they're gonna get them in, and then they need to not just get them in and signed up, but then they need to post activities and events and post their videos and pictures after their programs and at their meeting. They need to put some files in there for themselves, and the clubs that do the most are gonna get rewarded for that. And I hope that as people are in there, one, we're gonna get them in that way, and then two, that they're gonna stay in it because they're gonna see the value. That's my hope.
Because if it's the simpler and more streamlined it is, it'll probably be more effective.
More effective.
They
yeah.
get overwhelmed with, sometimes I
exactly.
think Facebook problem, son answers that, because there's like so much. And then I don't know if you all had, I guess you have the calendar online too. They make it.
And they link together. So we're gonna get to that.
Thank you.
A suggestion about communication. I think something like, once a month, because some sort of like a newsletter on the email form where you inform the parents things that are going on, and also that the parents could also write and contribute things, any suggestions or any questions or answers.
That's a great suggestion, something we've actually looked into. So just a matter of what we put in there. I looked at doing it, and we actually put a rough draft together, and then I looked at it, and I said, campus safety really doesn't have a whole lot of interesting stuff to give. We introduced the new staff members is what we were going to do in there. It just didn't flow. So we're going to continue to work on that. We're going
to
get a newsletter out.
Want us to know.
Yeah, exactly. Yes, ma'am.
Will you be working on having a code for your transcript for students?
So OrgSync actually provides a co-curricular transcript. That's an option in there. So what you end up doing with OrgSync, and I think that's a second step for us, we're gonna try and get them in and get them engaged first. But once, if we get this off the ground and running and working well, OrgSync will allow us to track student involvement, and so they can put in their clubs and their organizations, and they can attach to it their leadership, what their leadership roles are in there. They can also track everything else that they do, every program they go to, every community service event they show up at, and then at the end you click a button and it prints it off for you. Here's what you've done. And that could be a 4-year list of everything co-curricular that they've done. So it will be an option. Yes?
I don't know exactly how Uber works, but I do know it's not in Leesburg. And I'm wondering, is it just an insurance nightmare, or could it possibly be a work study on the weekend for some kids to be an Uber driver?
You know, I believe some students are using Uber, so I don't know all the details of it.
Mine is.
Okay, so there
yeah.
is Uber here.
So it's available.
It takes a while, so it takes like 20 minutes. For
That's
it.
Okay, as long as I know that it's here, because
yes.
I had heard that it wasn't here.
Eric
so,
used it.
Did he? Okay, so you just download the app and then
just put in your address, don't come.
That's based on availability of the drivers in the area when they're on and off.
Yeah.
Well, that's okay though.
You could have 5 drivers on, you could have 0 drivers on.
Well, as long as there's somebody, you know, she can wait.
Right.
You
can share a ride.
She can go the next day. I just need to know that there's someone.
Yes.
Yeah.
It is an option.
It's a
yeah.
lifesaver.
You and I, we've spoken about the fact that there were 2 tornado warnings for Leesburg, Florida.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I know it's something that you're working on, but now we're moving into the spring tornado season.
Mm-hmm.
So what is your timeline for getting that notification system in place?
Yeah, so the notification system exists. The question was about warnings on emergency situations, and I'll just kind of generalize it. You're asking specifically about tornadoes, but in a general sense, warnings on emergency situations. The system exists. We have it on campus. It is loaded with student information so that we can send a message to students if we need to. I think we've just done we haven't done a great job of getting that information out. And so what we are working on right now, I'm working with our campus safety director, and we are going through one by one a number of different situations and scenarios and things that we need a policy and a procedure and guidelines for and how to handle. So we are actually starting with weather. That is one of the top things on our list, and we've completed most of the weather stuff. We've moved into some other more serious situations as well a little bit that are not the fun ones to deal with, but could potentially happen and that we need to address. So weather should be done, I would say certainly by spring break. So within the next, 5 weeks? And when I say done, I mean, he and I have done it. It's been taken to the senior staff on campus and everyone's aware of it. And so hopefully that we can then implement that properly as we move forward from there. And then as we continually create these guidelines in all of them, what we hope to eventually have is just a book that would cover hopefully every situation we can possibly think of that could possibly happen, that we've got a procedure in place for it. And that's gonna take some time to get through all of them. And the reality is some of them are so unlikely, but we need to prepare for it. And so that's something I'm tasking our safety director with.
So you have a text message system?
Yes, yeah. So the text message system is there. And that's what I'm saying, the student information is already loaded.
But you're working on safety protocols,
yeah,
is what you're saying.
Right, because we have that system, but if we're not doing a good job of identifying the protocols and who's responsible for sending that message and who makes the call of when we send it and what we say, and I don't know that we've got all that laid out just right yet. And so, you know, if we don't have those steps in place, the ball's gonna be dropped. I think that's what's happened that you're referring to, that we, you know, there was sort of an expectation of, you know, who would notify, who would say anything, and what do we do? And yeah, we just don't know who's necessarily responsible for it or who's going to do it, and we're going to work through that. Well, if there's nothing else, thank you for your time, and hope to see everyone on the dance floor tonight.